On behalf of the seminary, let me extend my word of welcome to those of you who are guests at Day at Dallas. We will see you in and out of activities throughout the day, but it's a privilege to have you on the campus. Some of you are familiar with the Campus Crusade Four Laws booklet. There is a fifth law, and that is that we love you and have a wonderful plan for your life, and it relates to Dallas Seminary. We think the wise, the intelligent, the gifted, and people just like you ought to come to Dallas Theological Seminary. It's been a privilege this week, and I wanted to introduce to you guests, especially our guest for the week, Dr. Don Sunukjian, who has spent the week with us in our annual series on Bible exposition. And he has been taking us through vignettes and scenes in the narrative of the life of Jacob in the Old Testament. And it's been a very rich week. Dr. Sunukjian is the professor of preaching and the chairman of the Department of Christian Ministry and Leadership at the Talbot School of Theology in La Mirada, where there are a lot of earthquakes and ready for it to perish in there, but he's trying to preserve that as long as he can. Seriously, it has been great to have him back. He taught here for 10 years. He pastored in churches in California, Texas, and Arizona. He taught on our faculty for 10 years and then has been at Talbot for the last 20 years, but he also pastors a church on the side, and they would probably think that was central and the school was secondary, and that probably is a great way for them to think. But it's been a great week to have Don and his wife, Nell, here, and we're so grateful that you spent the week with us. Would you join me in welcoming Dr. Don Sunukjian?
Would you turn, please, in your Bibles to Genesis 32? Genesis 32. I'd like us to begin by reading an event from the life of Jacob. Genesis 32. It's the night before Jacob is going to cross the border back into his own land for the first time in 20 years. Genesis 32, beginning in verse 22. That night, Jacob got up, took his two wives, his two maidservants, his 11 sons, crossed the ford of the Jabbok River, which was the border. After he had sent them across the stream, he then sent over all his possessions. Jacob was left alone. A man wrestled with him till daybreak. When the man saw that he could not overpower him, he touched the socket of Jacob's hip so that his hip was wrenched as he wrestled with the man. And then the man said, "Let me go. It's daybreak." "I will not let you go unless you bless me." The man asked, "What is your name?" "Jacob." The man said, "Your name will no longer be Jacob. It will be Israel, because you have struggled with God and with men, and you have overcome." Jacob said, "Please, tell me your name." "Why do you ask my name?" Then he blessed him there. So Jacob called the place Peniel, "Because I saw God face to face, and yet my life was spared." The sun rose above Jacob as he passed Peniel, and he was limping because of his hip. Therefore, to this day, the Israelites don't eat the tendon attached to the socket of the hip, because that's where Jacob's hip was touched, near the tendon. When I was in my mid-20s, I tried to preach this passage. I couldn't do it. I didn't understand Jacob. I didn't understand God. I didn't understand myself. I was 25. It came during a summer internship while Mel and I were in seminary. We were up in Palo Alto at the Peninsula Bible Church for the summer. Ray Steadman was the pastor. There were three of us interns up there that summer. Each one of us was assigned to one of the areas of youth ministry, junior high, high school, college. I was assigned to high school. Each one of us all summer long worked within our particular department. But in addition to working in our area of ministry, each one of us knew we were going to have a chance to preach in big church. One Sunday morning in the main sanctuary. And so about a month before my turn was going to come up, I started to think, what will I preach on? And I went to this passage. I thought, man, there's got to be a great message in here somewhere. I mean, look at it. God wrestles with Jacob all night long, leaves him crippled, and blesses him. I mean, there's got to be a message in here. Some message that's going to wow the people, knock their socks off, make them say, who is that young man up there? He's good. Keep your eye on him. He's got a future. You can hear the ego in there. Well, I mean, I worked. I studied. For a week and a half, I just poured myself into the passage. And the longer I went at it, the more confused I got. I ended up with questions. That's all, questions. Some night, a man leaps out of the darkness and attacks Jacob. Who is this man? Where does he come from? Why does he attack Jacob? A little longer, it becomes apparent that this man is God. Why is Jacob? Why is God wrestling Jacob? And why can't God win? I mean, they go at it hour after hour. From whatever time Jacob sent the people across the river border until daybreak. I mean, we're talking 6-8 hours. And Jacob holds God to a draw until God zaps him, busts his hip, and then says, let me go. And then Jacob says, no. All night long, he's been trying to prevent this assailant from destroying him. And when the guy finally wants to go away, Jacob hangs on. And then God asks him his name. Why does God ask him his name? Who does God think he's been wrestling all night long? And then Jacob very politely says, could you tell me your name? We've been talking about mine. What is your name? And God won't tell him. Won't tell him. I gave up. I never did preach the passage. I don't remember what sermon I did preach. All I know is they never got the glorious one from this passage that I was planning. I was 25. I didn't understand Jacob. I didn't understand God. Didn't understand myself. As the years have gone on, I think I understand God a little bit better. I think I understand myself a little bit better. And as a result, as I come back to the passage, I think I understand Jacob a little better and what's going on here. What is going on here? What's the point? What's happening with Jacob? What does God want us to focus on in order for us to understand how he works in our life? What's the point? The point is this. This is the defining moment in your life when God breaks you and puts you on a path of blessing. This is the defining moment in our lives when the issue is settled between us and God. Is it going to be His way or our way? God's way or my way? What God wants or what I want? In my marriage, in my ministry, with my children. Am I going to do things God's way or my way? This is the defining moment when we are forever defeated. It's a magnificent defeat, for we are forever blessed. This defining moment will come at you out of nowhere, unexpectedly. Your mind will be on other things. You'll be preoccupied with something else. Your attention will be elsewhere, and all of a sudden, out of nowhere, this defining moment will hit, and it will determine whether your soul lives or dies. For Jacob, it came out of nowhere. Jacob was not expecting this. Jacob was preoccupied. His mind was elsewhere. He was focused on what was going to happen tomorrow. All of his thoughts, all of his calculations, all of his mental thinking was on tomorrow. Tomorrow he was going to cross the river border back into his own land for the first time in 20 years. He had heard that his brother Esau had gotten word that he was coming, and he had learned that his brother Esau had gathered an army of 400 men and was coming to the other side of the river border, and Jacob was afraid his brother was going to massacre him and his family. Why was Jacob fearing that his brother would massacre him? Because 20 years earlier, he had cheated his brother out of the family blessing. 20 years earlier, he had tricked his blind father, Isaac, into giving him the inheritance, into giving him the leadership of the family. And when his brother found that out, his brother was older, his brother vowed, "I will kill Jacob." And now Jacob is going back into the land, and he doesn't know what will happen. He had sent some messengers ahead to tell Esau that he was coming, and he had said to them, "See if you can get a reading on how Esau, has he softened any toward me?" Messengers came back, and they reported that Esau's only response to their notice was to get the 400 men, and he was just one day behind them coming up on the border. All of Jacob's thoughts are preoccupied. What can he do? How can he maneuver around the situation? How can he finesse it? How can he turn it to his advantage? How can he outwit him, Esau, again, so that he can survive back in the land? What can he do? Jacob has a plan. Jacob always has a plan, okay? He's always got a scheme. His scheme is he will take his family and all of his possessions, his thousands of animals. He will take them and divide them into two groups. The earlier part of our chapter tells us this plan. At widely separated spots on the border river, he will send across this half and this half. Then if Esau comes on one of them and massacres them, Esau will think, "I've wiped out Jacob." And then Jacob will cross the river himself and join himself to the other group, and he will find some place to survive. What a guy. What a guy. He gets another idea. Maybe he can prevent a massacre to start with. Maybe he can buy Esau off with gifts. And so Jacob gets 220 goats from his flocks. 220 of them. Bawling and scampering around. And he sends them across the border river, and he tells his herdsmen, "If you encounter my brother," and he says to you, "Who are you guys? Where are you going? Whose animals are these?" tell him they're Jacob's. Jacob wants you to have them. He wants to make up for what he did. And so 220 goats go across the border. And after they've set out and gone about half an hour, 220 sheep milling around, bumping into each other with the same message to Esau. They're Jacob's, but he wants you to have them. He wants to make up. And after the sheep, camels. And after the camels, cows and bulls. And after the cows and bulls, donkeys. Wave after wave after wave of expensive gifts to soften Esau. And that night, after he has sent across his family and all of his possessions, Jacob is alone on this side of the river, still thinking, is there anything else I could have done? Is there anything else I should be doing? Preoccupied, attention focused elsewhere. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, an assailant attacks him. That night, Jacob got up, took his two wives, two maidservants, 11 sons, sent them across the ford. After he had sent them across the stream, he sent across all the animals, his possessions, and Jacob was left alone. A man wrestled with him till daybreak. Out of nowhere. My friend, your defining moment, it will come out of nowhere, unexpectedly, when your thoughts are focused on something else. It did for me. 10 years after that egotistical summer in Palo Alto, I was the young pastor of a church in Scottsdale, Arizona. Scottsdale is a suburb of Phoenix. When I first went to Scottsdale Bible Church, there was a growth spurt for a couple of years. But then the attendance plateaued and started declining. The attendance started going down. This is not good, I said to myself. This drop in attendance. I grew up in a big church of several thousand. I wanted to pastor a big church of several thousand. We were not getting bigger, we were getting smaller. At Dallas Seminary, I graduated. I won the graduating award for the student who best represents the ideals of Dallas Seminary. In other words, the one who was the most likely to succeed. This is not success. I hope someday to teach at the seminary, to train others how to pastor and preach. Nobody wants a professor who hasn't done it and can't do it. The Christian magazines don't run too many articles of, I came to a church of 500 and under my leadership it became a church of 150. Something should be done. What can we do? What plans can we come up with? Let's think about it. Let's strategize. What can we do to reverse this trend? But instead of reversing, it got more severe. The graph on the attendance kept going down, and it didn't look like it was going to bottom out. And I was afraid that I was going to kill the church. I remembered something Winston Churchill had said in World War II. I have not been called to preside over the disillusionment of the British Empire. I thought I had been called to preside over the disillusionment of Scottsdale Bible. What would that do to me? What would that do to my self-image? How would I emotionally survive? Who would ever want me to be a teacher if I couldn't do it? If I killed this church, nobody else would ever call me to pastor their church. And out of nowhere, I was faced with a defining moment as to whether my soul would survive or not. Your defining moment will come unexpectedly. It may start with what seems like a nagging problem. A nagging problem in the marriage. Some sort of difficulty. Some sort of stupid argument that goes on for days, you know, about how to handle the finances or the in-laws or work schedules. It may start as a nagging problem in your ministry. One of the board members just doesn't like the way you're running the new youth program. Maybe disagrees with the counsel or advice you gave his daughter. Maybe resents you for canceling his Sunday school class. At board meetings, he sits at the other end of the table. Doesn't say anything to you directly. If you encounter him in the halls at the church, the conversation is always tight-lipped, brief, no warmth, nothing personal. It may start as a nagging problem with your children. They're having problems, behavioral problems. Disrespectful to teachers, getting in fights at recess, not paying attention in class. Maybe they're having social problems, hanging out with the wrong crowd, dating somebody undesirable. It starts out as a nagging problem. And you become preoccupied. What can I do with it? How can I, what should I say? What should I do? There must be a way of resolving this. How can I get around this marriage issue or this, what can I do with this board member? And all of a sudden it blows up in your face. What started as a nagging problem escalates and mushrooms into a catastrophe. What started as a problem that needed a solution has now become a disaster, which is heading to destruction. Now the marriage is practically falling apart. You hardly talk to each other. There is so much anger that sometimes one of you goes to a motel or stays with a friend. At church, the board member has been talking to others on the board, and they're beginning to see things his way, and you've been told that at the next board meeting, the main agenda on the item is your ministry at the church. You've been given a list of 8 areas of dissatisfaction that they want you to address, and you begin to see the handwriting on the wall. Now your child is staying out all night, and you don't know where. They're starting to show signs of addiction. They're becoming abusive to others in the family. They're getting in trouble with the law. And you're thinking, whoa, where did all of this come from? What's going on? It takes you a while to figure out it's God. It's not your spouse. It's not the board member. It's not your child. It's God. It's God and you. It's God who has leaped into your circumstances. It's God who has assailed your life. It's God who is wrapping himself around you, breathing on your neck, forcing you to look at him, demanding that he be central in your life, demanding that you yield. It takes us a while to figure out it's God. God trying to pull us away from our pride and self-centeredness. God trying to grab us from impurity and pornography. God trying to bring us back from the chase after money. It takes us a while to figure out that it's not anything other there than God and us. And that's why the struggle goes on for so long. Not just hours, months. We fight, we resist, we hold out. We do not realize it's God. Jacob did not know it was God. He thought it was a man, an assailant, an assassin, abandoned, maybe one of Esau's thugs sent to kill him. And so Jacob is going to fight him. Jacob expects to win. Jacob is incredibly strong. He could lift a boulder that four other teenagers could not lift. He's always been able to bend any situation to his will. He's always been able to handle anything and make it fit what he wants it to be. He'll take care of this situation too. He wrestles for hours. And he discovers that he cannot defeat this opponent. There seems to be some hidden power that this opponent has. And then finally, the man reveals who he is. He reveals that all along he has had a power to break us at any moment he wishes. And with a source of energy he has not used before, he cripples Jacob, and his hip is busted. And at that point, Jacob knows it is God. God came to the young pastor in Arizona, and he said, "Don, all your life you've lived with pride, ego, with your dreams and your ambitions. All your life you thought you could make success because of your abilities. Now do you see that it's in my power as to what's going to happen? Whether this church succeeds or fails, it is mine to determine, not anything that you are going to do or can do. Will you yield?" And at that moment, faced with the death of everything I wanted, something in me yielded. Yes. I will serve you, not my pride. If you kill this church and nobody ever hears from me again, I will serve you. I'll be a corn of wheat and I'll fall into the ground and die if that's what you want. But God, can I at least say it's what you wanted? Can I limp away from this with a little shred of my self-image still intact by saying you called me to bury the church? Can I be like Jeremiah, God? It says you called him to uproot, to tear down, to destroy. Can I say you called me? You know, if it fails, can I blame you? And God's answer was, yes, if it fails, I'll take the blame. And Don, if it succeeds, do I get the credit? Yes. Yes. And at that moment, I was free. I was free of worrying about myself and my image and my success and whether anyone would hear from me again or not. At that moment, I was defeated. Magnificently defeated. But from that moment has flowed the direction of my life. If you slay me, I will trust you. If you reward me, it will be your mercy. When Jacob realizes who he has been dealing with, he will not let go until God blesses him. He knows now who he has been wrestling with. He has been lamed. He will forever now have to lean on God. He will have to depend on God. He cannot handle life anymore himself. He has been forever defeated. He wants a blessing. And so after 7 or 8 hours with Jacob no longer struggling, just desperately clutching, he will not let go until God blesses him. And so God says to him, "What is your name?" Now, God's not asking for information. God is asking for a confession. He's asking for an admission. He's asking, what kind of man are you? Because in biblical times, a man's name told you what kind of person he was, what his personality was. So God says, be honest with me. What is your name? What kind of person are you? And Jacob, broken, says, my name is Jacob. In Hebrew, that means heel grabber. Because from the moment of his birth, when his brother Esau was born ahead of him, Jacob's hand came out of the womb holding the heel of his brother as though he wanted to say, no, 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 come back in. I want to be the leader in this family. He was a heel grabber from the moment of his birth, and he has been a grabber all of his life. My name is Jacob. That's what I am. I am a con man. I am a shrewd operator. I am one who manipulates and finesses and takes. I am Jacob. God says to him, no longer will your name be Jacob. You have wrestled with me. And though I have defeated you, you have overcome the larger issue of your personality and your ego and your pride and your scheming and your manipulation. You have overcome. You are going to be forever different. And I'm going to give you another name that will reflect how you will be in the future. Your name will be Israel, one who struggled with God and came out victorious. When the sun rose and Jacob reflected on what had happened, he gave a name to that place, Peniel, which in Hebrew means the face of God. I've seen the face of God and I'm still alive. And when the sun rose and Jacob walked toward the river to cross over into the other side, as he walked into the future to meet his brother Esau, every step he rose and fell and rose and fell, with a reminder for the rest of his life of that defining moment when God broke him and set him on a path of blessing. Is God bringing you to a defining moment? Your marriage, your ministry, your children? Is he bringing you to a moment when he is saying, is it going to be you or is it going to be me? Let it be him. It's a magnificent defeat. Lord, we are so glad we are in your hands for good. You have laid hold on us through the name of Jesus Christ, your Son, and you will not let us go. You will bless us. Thank you. In your Son's name, amen.